you've been there, you know, it's netting on the dead pigeons and they're hanging. And they just, they die in rafters of the wall. And they're far too high up there. So I was just very upset. I was thinking, this is epically pointless. I'm just like wasting my time. So I wrote it all down. And maybe a month or so later, with combined with other ideas, I wrote a story called Dusty Townsend. And Dusty Townsend ended up winning the Journey Prize. And when I think back that I was just dejected at writing in my notebook, and now I look at the book, this is one rare case where my notebooks are almost word for word on the page. The flea market was held every weekend in a massive wooden warehouse in the industrial part of the city near the railway tracks. It's the kind of neighborhood where the streets allude to form gigantic shallow ponds during the rainy season, and where an unlikely number of shopping carts spend their final days. I paid my 65-cent cover charge, took a big breath, and went into the main hall. I didn't go there often enough for its vastness and futility not to strike me again. Here there were hundreds of independent dealers set up at folding tables, which stretched in their rows far back into the room, the warehouse air smelling of oil, hot dogs and vinegar, body odor, cat litter, the aisles sluggish with people, the vendors pessimistic. I let myself drift with the currents of the sea, eyes down to pass the tables, trolling through cheap, newish merchandise that would be of no interest to any collective now or in the foreseeable future. Acres of airport novels, CDs suspiciously unboxed, video games, socket wrench sets, Ren and Stimpy t-shirts, boxes of paperclips, batteries, ballpoint pens that presumably fell off the back of a truck somewhere. And scattered among these tables were the personal collections, which were for their madness and desperation held a bit more promise of delivering the unexpected. These were the tables heaped with costume jewelry, constellations of twinkling, unwearable rhinestone earrings, pendants, tiaras, tables with shallow glass cases, stuffed full of coins or stamps, military medals, gold wristwatches, brazenly ugly cufflinks, with spent cigarette lighters. Tables stacked dangerously high, any item on top of any other, a collection of large format Japanese glamour magazines balanced on a pair of antique salad bowls, fondue sets, and a condiment tray in the shape of backs. I was getting on towards the back of the warehouse by this point, having seen nothing of interest. Here the black face of soaked timbers rose to a distant group, netted under the sheets of mesh to keep the pigeons from roosting there, but it only worked to keep them in, judging from the 6 or 7 mummified birds lying suspended in the nest. So there you go. Take notes. Take rule 5, make time. And this sounds really pedantic, but you know, Virginia Woolf wrote that Facebook room of your own. She was talking to women, of course, and saying you gotta, you know, get out from under the roof of your country or your father or whatever and have this separate place that's sort of sanctified to your writing. That, that point stands as crucial. But even within the context of having your own space and having your own life and control your own, this business of making time has been crucial for me over the years. It's either a time every day, or it's an amount of time every week, or it's just a part of your brain that you park and you reserve for writing. And that to me has been huge. Rule 6, read and reread. I'm sure this is said by most writers, but I can't imagine any writer that wouldn't say this, but for me it's been so crucial, and there's a particular kind of reading which is juice for your writing. You'll be reading novels, enjoying them, and reading short stories and making your point, and then you'll read one person, one writer, and you'll want to, you'll be enjoying it, but you'll feel this urge to put the book down and start writing. The effect of the writing is to make you want to start writing. You're going to be, I will do that, I will do, oh yeah. And whenever you come across an author like that, read everything they've ever written, and use the juice that you get off that to write. That's been really important for me. And over the years, the authors that had that effect on me have varied, you know, changed. I think Warwick Arbuthnot was the first, but far most important writer for me in the very early years of my writing, Chapter Then and Now, and St. Irvin's Workman. But then later, writers like Mavis Clance, and Janet Frank from New Zealand, Mark Manus, you know, for instance, absolute humor, really became very important to me at points in my life. And the last one is maybe a little bit counterintuitive. Rule 7, be private. And I say this for a couple of reasons. We all need community, right? We all need, and if we're writing, it's very beneficial to have writers around us and have conversations and learn from each other. But part of what we do when we're in the midst of creating the short first story or the article or the novel, it should be closely guarded. And there's a couple of reasons why. The first and maybe most important is that part of the talking about the work is satisfying. And it scratches an itch that you don't necessarily want to scratch. You want to scratch that itch by the issue. And sometimes when we speak about our work to friends and we do it too widely, we are so satisfied after telling them that there's very little energy or motivation to get back to the chat, right? And a lot of projects founder after having been discussed and discussed to the point that you have put your right out of your system. Allowing a project to haunt you and stay inside and secret while you're talking. I told maybe three people that I was writing in Denver Park, and part of it is fear of failure. You know, you want to fail in a small, in view of this few people's problem. So it's definitely part of it, but also because I knew that to talk about it before it was finished would extend something. And I kept a secret, and one of the greatest satisfactions in my writing life was in those weeks following publication when friends that I knew reasonably well would come up to me and say, you did what? You know, and that's actually very satisfying to prove yourself that you're able to be self-contained. Alright, other questions?
We are here to listen. When you say if there's a book that you read and then you want to write,
yeah.
I've come across two different books, but it's almost like they would sue me.
Well, don't write the book exactly in them.
No, but I mean, it would be like it's almost like it would take me into another area and it would just consume me.
I see.
Like it was just like my life
would stop. Well, you know, everyone's got to be their own judge in these matters, but in my experience, there are kind of two varieties of writers that you like.
Mm-hmm.
You know, some you like just for reading pleasure, and others you like with a real different kind of energy, a hungry curiosity about how specifically they're doing what they're doing, and they make you want to pick up your pen or they make you want to go to the keyboard. That feeling, whether or not what you're working on is the same or different, is helpful. So that's just
yeah.
So I thought I'd talk a bit about the Blue Light Project and read a very short section, and then I'll read some nonfiction, which comes from my story about the soldier Christian Ellis. But the Blue Light Project is sort of started in tragedy. My mother passed away about a week before the publication of my second novel, Story House. That affected me much differently and more profoundly than I expected. And I had a pretty shitty year after that, actually. And I became stupidly busy with various projects in a kind of agitated attempt to distract myself. I was doing a lot of traveling with magazine work at that time. So this sounds exotic, but it was really a function of me being highly displaced. So I remember I did a trip for a magazine to Shanghai at that time. I was talking to expats, and they were all the stories that they were telling me were stories of displacement and not feeling at home and not so understanding where they belong. And I did another story. It was very bizarre personal experience. I went to London to meet with a guy who does personal branding. So his business is to take people and like turn them into corporate brands. It's like this insane artificial process. And I paid so that they clients on behalf of a magazine that I was working for. And I went to London and I met him in this stupid restaurant where he had Brandon, the owner, and he sat with me and asked me all these questions, and then together over the ensuing weeks we sent out a questionnaire to my friends and to them to say what kind of cereal I reminded them of. And then me and this guy had a conference call, and he said, you're like pretty interesting cereal results. You're like how much context, except you also like still have oatmeal. And then he was telling me about this mint, and I was just thinking, oh God, I'm not dead, and you know, this is meaningless. And right around the same time, I had this crazy thing enter my life, which really is the start of Blue Light. I met this artist who had a studio in Hollywood, and he was a conventional artist and painter. I love his work. Couldn't really afford it. But he said one day to me, he said he was doing a new kind of project, and I want to come out with him while he put it up. And I said, out. He said, it's street art. I'm doing street art. And I said, okay, I've been doing this for a long time. And so he started walking me around the neighborhood, and he was putting up these posters. You know, this is not for me. It's like posters, photographs, banners, all kinds of stuff. And he was putting up LinkedIn and he photographed something at 1:1 ratio. So the picture was exactly the same.
top of the thing. So when you hit the wall, you get a picture of it, and then you post it right there, and so you, and she didn't notice it, and then you start to notice it, and then I realized, he put up like 500 of these things all around here. It was the most unbelievable project. And I started to become aware of other street artists. I was ready to go to college full time, so I wrote a piece about them, and they started coming out of the woodwork, and I got to know all the crazy stuff. And they took me out, they agreed to let me come with them, but they were very secret. They don't know their names, you know. I only got to know one guy whose name was listed about a year ago. He had never told me his name. He was a street name, Germ. I called him Germ for years. I was like, I Germ? He actually had a name, but I was still there. So they took me out and met me, but the deal was they got to look at my name. And that.